So good evening, everyone. Welcome to the WebEx on building an application server. The first course today will be taking you through cloud computing. So I hope all of you all have gone through the previous or the pre-workshop content. Have all of you all gone through the pre-workshop content on installation of Node.js and Mongo DB? Okay. So if you've not gone through, let's until people join in. I think we have 21 people participants at the moment. I'm sure that there are more at the ThingQbators, but let's wait for a few more people to join in. Okay. So let me take you through. If you've not done the installation, please look at the pre-installation workshop. Okay. So I'm sharing the link. These are the pre-workshop exercises. Right. So if you've not done, let's just start this pre-workshop exercise. I'll be going through the same for another 10 minutes from now before we start the first session. If you click on the link that was there that I gave to you in the chat. Okay, so let's go through the pre-workshop exercises on building an application server. For this, you would need, you have some prerequisites. I think if you go into the link that I've shared, we need something called an atom editor where you would be writing your code. Then you need something called a Docker where you would need to connect your codes that you're writing through this Docker. There's also a small programming language, Erlang, ERLANG, which we will be teaching you through. So there are some pre-installations for the same, and there is installation of NodeJS in the Mongo database. Please mute yourselves as soon as you join in. So let's start with the exercises, the pre-workshop. So there are a few slides. Let's just go through this quickly. Okay. So all these are the 7 exercises which are there in your pre-workshop. You would need to install Atom IDE where you will be writing the codes. Okay. And then this is how you install. So please go into the link http://atom.io, or you click on this link, you should be able to, it will reroute you to the page where you can download the Atom IDE. Okay, so once you've installed the Atom IDE, we would also need you to search for the package. So if you go over here to the install section of the Atom, there are a few packages. As this workshop contains snippets of Node.js, you would need to install Node.js. Okay, so you go to install, and then in the install packages, you search for Node.js, and you should be able, and you should install this Atom Node.js snippets. Right, Atom Node.js snippets. So this is a library or a package that you would need to install. You would need to install. Okay. Please mute yourselves as soon as you join in.
Please what? The link isn't getting open.
Guys, please mute yourselves because there are other people who are in the workshop as well. Okay, so let's just go on to the second exercise of the Docker installation. The Docker installation tutorials are given in this workshop exercise number 2. Right, so this is a Docker for Windows. So download this Docker Hub through this link. So if you click on this link, you should be able to get the link. Is it still a problem? Is the pre-workshop link working for everyone? please reply if you are not able to view the content of this free workshop. Okay, so let's go back to the other applications, the other content in the pre workshop. After you install Docker, okay, so you need to click, you need to sign up over here and install the Docker onto your computers. Then you need to, you can just have a shortcut so that it becomes easier for you to copy and paste and run the codes that you have. The other things, I think for this is a very generic content. You need to install Arduino IDE and NodeMCU because we'll be showing you a few experiments where the NodeMCU will be connected to your application server. So please make sure that, okay, so let's, I'll just share you the link. Please give me a minute. So I've just shared the WebEx link. Let me share how the WebEx link will look like. If you click on this link and log in on your portal, right? So you would need to first log in to the ThingQbator.lib.in portal, after which this is the WebEx link. Here, the WebEx link of cloud computing is on the first page. So over here you need to join this WebEx. People from IIITMK, are you able to hear the audio? Please text if you're able to hear the audio, because we received a message that you're not able to hear us from here. Are you able to hear us? Okay, great. I think it's working at IIITMK as well. So let's continue over here. So if you click on join WebEx, it'll take you to the WebEx page. Join the WebEx link. Right? So you can just open it on your browser over here. After which, this is the link for the WebEx content. Hi Anmol, I think there is audio, people are able to hear, so please try to turn on your speaker. Okay, so once you go on to the content, you should be able to get all the links over here. So if you say start course, you will be starting the course which has, there are a few people who've not muted themselves, so please make sure that you mute yourself as soon as you join in. Please mute yourself as soon as you join in. Okay, so this is how your pre-workshop exercise page or your WebEx workshop exercise page will open. Please finish the pre-workshop exercises which are over here. And we will be starting the cloud computing in another 5 minutes. So please make sure that you have completed all your pre-workshop exercises. If you have any queries, please do message us. If possible, we will sort it out now or slowly through the course content. Right? So through the content of this course, we will be helping you do the installations as well. So if you are not able to do it currently, no problem. You can start with whatever you've done and we will do the installations on the fly. Okay, so good evening, everyone. Welcome to the start of the second WebEx on application server. We'll be starting with the topic of cloud computing. For people who've not been able to install, we will help you out in some time. Once we start with the exercises, we will definitely help you out with installations where there is a back channel which will be coming up to help you. So so hopefully most of you all have attended the last WebEx, which was on computer processing, image processing and computer vision, right? So that was an initial topic where we taught you about how images can be used to process data, where your camera acts as the eye for the computer, right? So now we will be telling you a step further, where after we process the data in a local machine, how do we transfer data across the globe, right? So one of the buzzwords today in the industry is cloud computing, right? Cloud computing, AI are the most used terms currently today in the industry. So we will start with teaching you what cloud computing is, how cloud computing will be beneficial, also why and when do you choose if you want cloud computing or not. Okay, so getting through the contents for this workshop, we will be taking you through what cloud is, what is a web server. There will be some installations and some experiments done using Node.js. There will also be an installation of MongoDB. MongoDB is a database service where you can store information. Okay, and there will be a small experimental phase of this WebEx where you will be reading and displaying temperature values or anything. So we could play around and see what we could build using whatever we've learned for today. Okay, so let me just put up a poll. I want you guys to answer the poll before we start the session. So for all the participants over here, there is a small poll which is put up. Please answer the poll so that we understand how we stand in taking you further. For the people who have not been able to install, we will help you out in some time. The starting part of this WebEx is going to be mostly on what and how cloud computing is. So we will not, you need any of these installations. So once when we come into the installation, we will be taking you individually and trying to solve the issues that you have. Okay, so please fill up the poll so that we will be able to continue with the workshop. So I think most of you have put in your poll questions. That's great. I had a very nice audience last WebEx where it was very interactive. So I expect like all of you all to interact with the answers that you have, maybe some questions that you have, which will help this community as the ThingQbator, which will develop knowledge all of us are learning. So it will help us learn better new things in today's workshop. Let's make best use of this time and let's do this together. Okay, so let's start off today's workshop on cloud and web servers. So can someone answer on the chat saying that what is cloud, right? Can someone tell me what cloud is? Can you put up some answers? We'd like you to answer on this so that I understand that people are listening to the workshop. So please put up your answers on the chat. What is cloud? I don't want a definition, an internet definition, but maybe tell me what cloud is. So I'm waiting for people to answer. So I hope you guys answer from the next question. Okay, I get one answer, which is delocalization of data. Very true. You are putting data across multiple locations. What is the first thing when you say cloud? What is the first thing that comes to your mind? Yeah, it's a web storage. Okay, it's a kind of an online storage network of servers on the internet to store data other than PC. Okay, what else? What is a cloud? Okay, let's not talk about cloud as some technology at the moment, but what is cloud? Right, so just to give an analogy of what cloud is, yeah, it is the internet. Okay, great. Memory access through internet, yes. Okay, so let's not talk about technology, right? What is cloud? So we see clouds when it's going to rain, that we see that there is a lot of cloud which joins in, right? So cloud is something that is away from us but still holds some information about whether it's going to rain or not rain, it gives you shelter. There's a lot of information just in the clouds that you see in the outside. If you check outside, there are clouds, right? So, yes. So, specifically what I was looking for, cloud is something like a virtual storage. So, if cloud, you could send something and place something on the cloud and you could just keep it there where people can see whoever has access to it. That is specifically cloud. So just to start off on what cloud and what are the capabilities of cloud. Cloud is an on-demand we request you to mute yourselves as soon as you join in. Please mute yourselves when you join in. Thank you. So yeah, cloud is something. So cloud is something which I think there's a lot of echo or reverberation. Please mute your mics so that it becomes easy to continue. So just to start off on what cloud is currently my computer. For example, I was hosting this whole information of this WebEx and you were able to access it based on a link that I had given to you, right? So my computer, which is over here, is essentially the cloud. Okay, so if you had access to do some processing on the information that I have on my computer, that is cloud computing. Okay, so to see the actual definition of what cloud computing is an on-demand delivery of IT resource over the internet with a pay-as-you-go pricing. Okay, so why do we need cloud? We can say we would need cloud instead of buying or owning any physical data center. People have set up these data centers where they give you access and you will be able to access information, put information, get information and a lot of other processing on the data centers and the spaces that people have set up for you. So this is specifically cloud computing. Excuse me. Yeah, so who uses cloud computing? Right, so today we see that cloud computing is used everywhere. People starting from delivery, food delivery, to IT industries, to big industrial automations, everyone is trying to use cloud because data becomes easy to visualize on the cloud and you will have access sitting in one corner of the world to the other side of the world. So information is accessible very easily. So Cloud is nothing but a platform where information is provided to people wherever you are remotely so that you can use that information to do some processing. Okay, so there are a large number of organizations who host these data services or data centers which provide servers for us to pay per use kind of a model that they run on. So AWS is one of the bigger agencies which have cloud services. Google has a lot of cloud services. Your Google Drive is basically a cloud-based service. Excuse me. DigitalOcean has a lot of good features on the cloud. So please let me know on a chat if anyone else knows any other cloud or if you have used any cloud machines or cloud servers before. So you could message in so that people are aware of what are the kind of cloud services which are available and what are the things that people are using, right? So okay, Heroku, Google Drive. It's interesting to see what iCloud, yeah, okay. So all this has a lot of applications and okay, Firebase, AWS, IBM has Watson, OneDrive, yes. Okay, so great. So why do we need cloud, right? Information previously, when information started. Please mute yourselves so that it doesn't become uncomfortable for others who are in the session. Okay, so why cloud? Why do we need cloud, right? So as information in the olden days, I think right now we see it only in the movies that we see that information as parts of letters used to be sent through pigeons, right? So by the time the pigeon would come from the person's place to wherever you are, you never know if the information has come correctly, not come correctly, or did the person intend to send it to you or not, right? So then came a postal service, right? So you had a pin code and then you could actually post any letters and all those things through an address, through the postal code, where people, the postal agencies used to deliver these posts at your home. And then came emails, right? So emails are something which given information almost instantaneously, right? So now information has moved on from a very nascent stage into a very advanced stage where people want to visualize information sitting at their home, right, of a remote location wherever you place your sensor. So for example, if there is an industry where you need to monitor the pressure of all the pipes that are running in the industry, right, how do you do that? Someone is sitting in the US, but he has all his machinery and his factory running in India. How is he going to visualize that? So cloud is a solution which makes it very easy. So excuse me. So cloud will help visualize all the information. Cloud will help you take all the information which is there at a remote location and give it to the person who is there sitting anywhere in any part of the world which has internet connection, right? So what are the benefits of cloud computing? It is agile. It is elastic. It has a lot of flexibility in terms of what you could do with the servers. It does cost saving, right? So for example, if I wanted to have my own data server and it would cost me say 1,000 rupees, right? So if you just have cloud, 1,000 rupees is just an example. It's not 1,000, it's in a few $1,000, if you would say, right? So only a small scale system would cost that much. A large scale system would cost you much more than that. So how cloud is basically that you get a part of their Yeah, I think we have set all the configurations of the audio correctly on our side. Please check the audio on your end. If you are not able to hear, please turn on the speaker volumes or anything like that so that it helps. But from our side, I think the audio is working fine. Okay, so the web servers are specifically something like a website, right? So you can host a website. It has a URL and it has a protocol which is called the HTTP protocol, right? So your web servers are something which consists of both the hardware and the software. It can only consist of the software or only the hardware, but essentially if you want to have a complete system, it consists of the hardware and the software which is running on a website to visualize some information. So these web servers are picking up information directly from the device and trying to display it over here if you write the code that way. So say for example, last time you had seen image processing, right? So there was an IP camera example over there where we had given a local host ID and you were able to see the camera feed on your Chrome browser, for example. Right, so that was an example of a web server where information from the outside world is taken. Just please give me a minute, I'm replying to Anmol. Okay. So we understood what a web server is. Let's see what a HTTP server is, right? So a HTTP server is a piece of software that understands your web addresses, which is your URL. So for example, you say www.google.com, that is your web address or the URL specifically. And it also understands the HTTP protocol, right? So there is another HTTPS protocol, which is a secure platform where if you want security which is built into your website, you would need to install a small certificate onto your web page where it will give you security of viewing and displaying information through your website. Right? So what happens when you type your URLs on the URL link, on the URL tab of your browser, what specifically happens? Can someone tell me what happens? Okay, I think we've got a URL is translated into an IP address, that's okay. Okay. Guys, please mute yourselves so that. Please mute yourself so that it doesn't create a problem. Okay, converts the URL to the IP to find the server. It does a DNS resolve. Yes, that's true. So essentially, there is a request which reaches your web server. The HTTP server accepts the request and finds the document which is basically doing the DNS resolve. And over here, if you get a response which is called 404, right? So 404 is a number where a response, if you get the response as a 404 response, it means that it does not exist. So if you get a response which specifically says 404 and could not resolve your IP address, it means that the typed in URL does not work and it will give you an error code of 404. Okay, so this was what specifically the web servers do. Let's go on to see what is an application server. Okay, so what we're going to teach today is an application server. What we're going to teach today is an application server. The application server just runs an application without having a specific website or an address to it. So, for example, if you have a server which is acting as an application which runs an application where you are able to log in and feed in information to your cloud or whatever is there. Okay, so now you have seen what is the difference between a web server and an application server. Let's try to see what is the difference between a local server and a cloud server. I think this is a very easy topic and most of you all know what is the difference between a local server and the web server. A local server specifically means that the information that you have is stored on the device's hard disk or an external memory that you have, which is connected to your PC. So for example, if I have a pen drive which is connected to the PC and I have information over there, this PC can be called a local server. Or a service which is connected over a single IP address, not over the internet, is called a local server. Okay, a server which is connected over the internet and it can be part of a remote location, that server is a cloud server. So you have data which is accessible from any part of the world or through this cloud server. Okay, so most of you know what is the difference between a cloud server and a local server. As you had mentioned the different cloud platforms that you have been using. So what are the specific factors that you would need to consider before you choose cloud? So cloud is something like a buzzword today, where people want to use cloud and want to have applications running on the cloud. But how do we know that it is critical, or how do we know that it is important to have cloud in your application or whatever idea or the project that you're doing? Why do you think cloud would be necessary, or why do you think cloud is not necessary? Right? Both ways are fine. So the first factor to see why cloud is required is that you have to see how much uptime you want for your business or for your idea or your project, right? So how much uptime specifically means that how long or what is the duration of the processes or the applications that is running for your idea. So if you want continuous running and if you want some information which has to be accessible very quickly without any dependencies of the internet, you should use a local server. But if you don't have any dependencies of being very real time, or if you want to see information across the internet, right? So then you would need to use a cloud server. So for sharing information over the cloud, as you see that cloud solutions are more expensive than in-house servers. So cloud servers are more expensive than local servers, but has the benefit of outreach, or it can reach a lot of people, which can outweigh the cost of for some businesses. What this specifically means is that, so for example, if you had only a local server, but you had to send information across a lot of places, right? So the local server, you would need to have a person who takes information from the local server and pushes it through a service, through an email or anything like that, to a lot of people. But excuse me. But if you had cloud as a service, which is already existing in your architecture, then it becomes easy for multiple people on multiple locations to get the information directly. So one of the questions asked over here is that, is the data safe on the cloud server? Right? So I would say definitely yes, if you are going in for a secure server, which is provided by companies like AWS, DigitalOcean, IBM and things like that, or Azure, Google Cloud, not mentioning anything specifically over here, but if they have services of security and there is an access that you are actually creating, then the data becomes very secure. Though there are a lot of risks of people hacking into your servers if enough protection is not provided, but a general security layer is always provided by the service provider who is giving you this cloud space to work on. So on a whole, if you do not have very confidential information that need not be transferred and has to be only present in your local system. So for example, people in a bank would not put their applications or the amount or whatever they have into a public server, right? So they would have their local servers which are connected in their network, which helps them do their computations, right? So if it is a very data critical information and you do not want people to access that data, even with access or try to hack it, generalized cloud services are not recommended, though there are people who are providing specific personal cloud spaces, which are used by companies like the finance companies and other companies which are very critical. So you can say that if you have any information which has to be secured, please choose the cloud service wisely, which provide the security features on their application. Okay. So for example, if you take an online business, okay, so uptime on an online business. So for example, you have Flipkart or you have Amazon, which is actually selling products or commodities to you today. If, for example, Amazon would completely crash or would work only once in an hour, right? So how would you feel on the same? Because if they had information in their local servers and they would push only part of their information into the cloud server, it wouldn't be very pleasing of an experience for you, right? But if, for example, there are companies who do not want to rely on internet, like, for example, there are defense companies or anything like that who have very secure information, then local servers are a must. So from this, I think we have to take away that based on the application that we are going to build and the need, we should actually decide if we want a local server or a cloud server, right? So does anyone else have any questions on local server or cloud servers? Or if you would like to enlighten the community over here with some points, what is the difference, or why local servers or why cloud servers, apart from whatever what I've told, please message on the group. So I think we have gone ahead from local servers and cloud servers. Let's now start with a few experiments. For these experiments to happen, you would need to install Node.js. Let me just start a small poll currently. So I put a small poll for everyone to answer. So did you understand what is the difference between a cloud server and a local server? So if you did, please put in the poll. Once we start with the poll, once we finish the poll, we will start discussing about installation of Node.js. So let's get back to installation of the Node.js. So this was there in the pre-workshop. Let me just go through each step by step so that people understand and are able to follow through. If you are able to do the installations well, there is a lot of example codes and experiments which are existing. We'll be showing you a few, but through the four modules that we are doing in the application server, you will be going through a lot of hands-on experiments. So let's just try to finish the installations today so that it becomes easier for people who are there. So please click on this link. Please click on this link, nodejs.org.in. Okay, I think Akash had a question about why do we avoid local servers nowadays? I would say that we don't avoid local servers. It's just that people want information at a remote location. Hence, people are using the cloud. But there are a lot of people who are still using local servers who do not connect to the internet and want to keep their data private or secret. So hence, they use the local servers. But the number of people who are using local servers are limited because people who really want information to not go out into the internet are very few. That's the only reason why the number of local servers have reduced with the emergence of the cloud servers. Right? So let's go step by step into the installation of the Node.js. I think Node.js installation, most of y'all should have done. So let me start a small poll on people who have installed Node.js so that it becomes easy. So please answer the question of the installation of Node.js. Based on the number of people, we will go through the installations quickly so that it doesn't waste the time of other people. So Sagar has a good point over here that says that local servers are less secure than a local servers or cloud servers, right? So the question comes or boils down to the point where let me just answer that in a bit. Okay, so I would say that the local servers are maybe more secure than the cloud servers because the local servers are not connected to remote locations unless someone comes and puts in a pen drive or connects over the internet or connects to that local server. He will not be able to access the network. So someone who's trying to hack from a far away or a remote location will not be able to do it if it is a local server. But if security measures are not taken care of in your cloud service, people sitting anywhere can access your database and can hack into your network. The point is, it's all based on how much security that you have on your cloud network. If you are secure enough, or if you're using a good service or a service provider, then it does not become too much of a problem. Both will be secure. Okay. So the next question which was asked was, what is Cloud SIM used for? Cloud SIM is basically a simulation tool for your cloud resources. So if you want to simulate, or you want to see how the cloud is managing the resources, then you could use Cloud SIM for specifically simulation, but it cannot be deployed into the open world at the moment. So let's go through the installations very quickly so that we can finish the installations and move on. So Node.js installation is done. Let me see how many people have done it. Okay, I think 35 people have already done it. For people who are still trying to install Node.js, please see how you can catch up. We will also help you after this workshop if you are facing any difficulties in Node.js installation. Okay, so once you have installed Node.js, go to your command prompt. Okay, please go to your command prompt. Go press the Windows key and open your command prompt. If you're using Linux, please open the terminal. Once you open the terminal, please go to the location where you have installed your Node.js. Let me just show you through how to do that. So go to your command line, which is command prompt on your Windows. Press the Windows key and type cmd. You should be getting a command prompt like this. In the command prompt, please type npm install -g http -server. Okay, so over here we're trying to install a HTTP server. Let me just show you how it will look on my computer. So this is my command prompt over here. Okay, over here you would need to type npm install -g http -server. So it will run a small script which basically says that your HTTP server is updated to the latest package which is present. Okay, so the latest HTTP server libraries are installed into your computer. Once we do that, we go after we install the Node.js, let's see how we can run a specific code on your Atom IDE, which will be able to host a HTTP server. Okay, so this is the code for the HTTP server. This is the code for the HTTP server. I'll be telling you how to get the code onto your computer. So if you go to the workshop page over here, I hope everyone's able to see the workshop page. If you go to the workshop page, there is the part of cloud computing in your WebEx workshop page. Let me share the link to you. Please open the link that I have given on the chat. The link is opening for everyone. Please open this link. You should get the page called Cloud Computing. Okay, there is an error. So I'll be sharing the main link for the WebEx. So please click on this main link for the WebEx and choose Cloud Computing. Let me show you if you click on the link that I've sent you. Workshop build an application server. Okay, it will open up this page. If you click on cloud computing, once you have logged in, if you click on cloud computing, it will redirect you to the page which I am showing you currently. People who have got the second link, please check this link. Are you still getting a database error? Okay, so it says database error. Please wait a minute. We will fix the database error. I hope the error is resolved currently and it's opening for everyone. Please refresh your page and it should open up this page. Okay, so once this has opened up to this page, if you scroll down to things, you need to install the Atom ID. What are the things which are required? The Atom ID and the codes. Okay, so the codes is a link to a zip folder which is present with which has the few codes that we are going to run today. So please download, please click on this link codes and download the zip folder onto your desktop. Download it onto your desktop, or if it is in your download folder, please cut and paste the whole folder onto your desktop. So if still the error establishing a database connection is coming, please wait for a minute, refresh, and it should work. So I hope the issue of the database is solved. I have put up a poll where I have asked if you are able to download the zip file. Please download the zip file and place the folder on your desktop. please extract it on your desktop so that you will be able to view the codes in a folder. So you need to type extract to the folder. So there should be a folder in which whatever was extracted is present. Okay. So please extract it as a folder on your desktop. So let's wait for the people who have not got it. Is it still coming as a database error? Are you still getting a database error? Please reply on the group if you are getting a database error. We request everyone to put in their poll so that we understand how many people have done it and how many people have not done the download of the code which is there on the portal. For the people who are not able to download the code, can you please describe what is the issue that you have or what is the issue that you're facing for the download? Let's wait for another 2 minutes to finish the download so that we can proceed with the experiments that we have on hand. I just shared the link address for downloading the code. So please click on the link that I've shared with you so that you will be able to download the code directly onto the computer. Okay, so let's begin by going to the location of the code. So let me show you how the code is situated in my computer. Okay, for me, I have saved the code called zip_final in the C drive. It's advisable to save the code in your C drive itself. So let's go into the folder zip.zip_final. Here is the hello.js code. Okay, so if you want to run this code, there is the instruction which is there. Okay, so you need to open the atom ID. Okay, so let's wait for the atom ID to open. Once the atom ID is open, let's open a new file. Let's open a file and go to the location. For me, it is present in the C drive. In C drive, zip_final and hello.js. Okay, so this is a simple code which is basically going to write hello world on your desktop. Okay, so once we do this, okay, we need to run this code. So if you remember the last experiments of Python, we used to open the Python code in the Nano IDE or the VI or the Vim IDE, and then we used to run it by executing the Python command. Okay, so let's go to the location where it is present. So let's go to this location of the Windows folder, the Explorer. On the top bar, on the ribbon, you should type cmd. Okay, so if you type cmd, automatically the path of that location will come up in the front. Otherwise, you would need to go to this location manually. So if you type cmd, let me show you again. If you go to the location, so in my C drive, I have the folder called zip.final. I go into this folder. In this folder, I type cmd. Okay, so it comes as C drive and zip underscore final folder is already selected over here. Okay, so to run this this code over here, you would need to execute the command. Node hello.js. Okay, so let's execute the code node hello.js. So let's execute the code node hello.js and press enter. The code now is supposed to be working. So let's check if the code is working over here. So in this code, we see that if you go back to the code, it creates a HTTP location where the port number is 8080. So if you give the IP address and port number as 8080, this web page will open up which says hello world. Okay, so let's see if that actually happens. So let's click on HTTP localhost colon 8080, and you see that there is hello world over here. So let's see if this code is actually running or we have made that separately. So let's edit the code hello.js. Okay, so let's go back to the hello.js code on Atom ID. Let's write hello, welcome to the Webex. So welcome to the Webex workshop. Okay, so let's just save this code. Now go back to the location of the zip folder or the folder where the codes are actually present. You type cmd and you should get this location. Once you get this location, let's type node hello.js. Right, hello.js. Okay, now as we have seen, it should actually type out whatever we have typed. So I have said welcome to the workshop, the Webex. So let's see if that has actually happened. So I refresh this page. Now you see that the whole page is over here. So now on the localhost port number 8080, I have hello, welcome to the Webex workshop. So over here, if you can actually write a complete HTML file with CSS, which basically helps you to put in colors, fonts, arrange all the things that you have in a certain order, then you will be able to host this page on a local server. So you see that on, if you remember, we were running a web server. So if you're running a web server on a local machine, now this is a local server where we are running a website which is in the port number 8080. Okay, so this is how we run a small web server. Let's go to the next experiments. So let's see what we have done over here. So we finished the installation of Node.js and hopefully everyone's able to get the output, right? So let me just start a poll over here. So please put your polls over here if you are able to get the output. Type in whatever you want to type on the page and see if that actually pops up on the localhost 8080 port number page. Okay, so I think most of you all are able to get the Node.js code to be working. Someone has replied that the Node.js code is not working, so please send a private message about why it is not working, what is the issue that you are facing. So I hope everyone's finished the experiment of Node.js. There was a small question in the group where you wanted to know if you could run Node.js on Atom. Atom is specifically an editor which is used to write your code. You can save the code and run it the way we have. So currently, what I believe is that Node.js files will run locally. You need to run it separately by tapping node and your file name on the location where you have saved your location. And Atom is used to just write the code. It is an editor where you will be able to put it there. I think one of the people has an error. We are looking into that and we will give you a resolution for the same soon. Yeah. So let's go into the next experiment. Once we finished the Node.js, let's see what MongoDB is. Right. So MongoDB, the full form is a Mongoose database. Okay. So please mute your mics. Do not play music or anything like that in the mic, because this is a forum for everyone to attend for the WebEx. So let's go back to MongoDB. Right. So how many of you all have finished installation of MongoDB? So I have put in a small poll which asks you whether you have installed the MongoDB. If you have not installed the MongoDB, please click on the specific website which is given over here. Okay, so you need to go through the MongoDB setup. So once you have done the setup, please choose click and leave everything as default as is over here. So please choose the default locations. Keep your data directory and your log directory as default. Please choose the complete setup. Do not choose the custom setup. Okay. And if you click on next, you will go into the MongoDB compass, which is a graphical user interface for MongoDB. Okay. So please install that as well. Wait for it to finish. Okay, so MongoDB is something like a database. So for example, to give you an so MongoDB is your database part where you are able to store information. So for example, if there is an automated industry, for example, and they want to measure the flow of any fluid through a particular pipe, right? So all this can be done only if you have any databases which are there, which can store information over a long period of time. So for example, if you do not have a database, you do not have a memory. And if you do not have memory, you will not be able to store any data in an organized manner, so that you can retrieve it from wherever you want and whenever you want. So databases are usually timestamped and has information which has a historic or a pre-dated value to it. Okay. So you might want to know what is the flow rates of the fluids in a certain pipe over a full year, right? So all the information of the flow rates over the year can be stored in the database, where your tool can pick up information from the database and be used for visualization of a processing. Okay, so let's go into the next experiment, which is my DIY playground. Okay, so I hope everyone's come to the DIY playground. So here we would need to install the necessary dependencies which are needed for this experiment, please go through this page. Okay, so again for this over here, you would need to go back to the desktop folder. In your desktop folder, you would need to type cmd, the folder where you have the zip underscore file located. Please go into that file and type this command over there. So you can copy the command, which is a very big command over here. So the command is npm space I space mongoose space express hyphen sanitizer ejs method hyphen override space node mon space body parser space mongodb. Okay, so these are a few dependencies which are needed. Maybe once you start understanding and trying some experiments using the databasing structures, you will understand why these dependencies and why these libraries are required. Most of these libraries have thorough explanations of why these libraries are used. So for example, if you want to do a sorting application, or you want to find out whether a pattern is what has to be detected, then you will use libraries and packages which will allow you to compute all these patterns or attributions easily. If you have a generalized topic, say if you want to sort of bag full of red flowers and blue flowers, right? So if that is one of the problems that you would want to solve, right? So there will be sorting packages which will be present in your database, so that you can easily place them in a way such that your processing becomes easier before you store it into your databasing structure. Okay, so please type in the complete command, which is over here, npm imongoose express hyphen sanitizer, the whole command over here. Okay, let me show you how it will look. Okay, so I will go to my zip folder over here. This is my zip folder. It's in my C drive, but if you have placed it in your desktop, no problem. You can type cmd, it will open up a command line interface. And you could copy and paste the whole command from the presentation that is there with you. So it will run a few programs which will give you two packages, two folders. One folder is called node underscore modules and package log.json. Okay, so these are those two are the packet, are the folders which will be created in the location of your directory. So one is called node modules and one is called package log.json. So these are the two files, or the one is a folder and one is a file. Node modules is a folder and this is a file. Okay, so the whole thing is will be created in the location wherever you have the code which is downloaded. So let's go and see what do we do next. So we need to locate the path of the MongoDB, right? So how do we locate the path of the MongoDB? If you have installed it with the default settings, it will be present in your C drive. Program files MongoDB server 4.2/bin, right? So you see over here there is a full address which is given over here. Let's go to this address. Okay, let's go to this address. So let's go to program files, C drive, program files, MongoDB, server /4.2/bin. Okay, C drive, program files. So I hope everyone has got the path which is located for your MongoDB. Please go to that location. Okay. And in that location, please type cmd. Okay. Let me just show you how it will work. So I go to my C drive. I go to program files. I go to program files. Okay, I have installed MongoDB. I go to server 4.2 bin. Okay. Here I need to type cmd. Okay. The whole path will come over here. Now if you see what I was showing over there, you would need to type mongod. Okay. mongod. Over here. So you type mongod over here. And you will get the MongoDB with a PID and things like that over here. Okay, so you're basically now it says that the database is running. So now you have your database which is running. Once the MongoDB server is up, so now that you know that the MongoDB server is up and a new command prompt terminal, tap the following code. Okay, so now we have finished the experiment over here. Let's go back. Let's go back to the folder. Go back to the folder where we had initially installed the codes. So for me, it's in C drive, zip file, and the code is over here. Okay. In the code, you would need, in this folder, you would need to type nodemonabb.js. So you see that there is an ABB code over here. So you need to go inside DIY playground. Okay. There is ABB.js. So let's go over here and type command cmd. Okay. In this cmd, you have to type nodemonjs.ap. Yeah. So nodemonabb.js. So I think most of you all would have got an error which is this. Okay, let me just show you. Okay. Let's go back to the screen. Over here in the zip file, you have the DIY playground. Please go into the DIY playground and type cmd. Okay. So now you've got a command line interface where you are basically getting your cmd. Okay. So now for this, after you install and you ran the MongoDB, you started the Mongo database. Now we need to run this code called nodemonapp.js. Okay. So now if you run nodemonapp.js, most of you will get a code because saying that nodemon is not installed. So let's go to this, let's go through this installation procedure where we need to say npm install -g nodemon. Okay, so npm install -g nodemon. Okay, so if you say install the nodemon, it will install the nodemon first. Okay, and we'll say that nodemon package is working. Now let's type the code nodemon app.js. Okay, so if you type nodemon app.js, it will start running the application server which you have actually created now. So let me show you the outputs of how it. So over here in the code, if you see that the port number is 3000, it is listening on port number 3000. So you would need to type the IP address http://localhost:3000/again. Okay, so let's see if the code is actually working. Let's copy this command, this URL, and go to my browser. Okay, in the web browser, I type http://localhost and the port number is 3000 over here. Okay, so let's type 3000. And we are able to get the temperature value. So this is an experiment what we have written over here. Okay, so most of you all will be able to see that the temperature value in the JSON format and the JSON data is temperature 36. If you click on submit, it goes to an IP address, if you see, saying that send data /36. It has sent the data from your web server into your database. So you see that the data is stored in your database. So if you want to change the temperature value, now you want to put 38 as your temperature value, you can click on submit, and the value of the temperature is again stored in your database. So now you should have two stored values in your database. So now you would need to open up the database. If you remember, we have put in the values of 36 and 38 into the database. So now let's open up the database. Let's open MongoDB. Compass. So coming back to the settings, we were installing the MongoDB Compass. Hopefully everyone has installed MongoDB Compass. Have you installed MongoDB Compass? So if you've not installed the MongoDB Compass, please install the MongoDB Compass. Once you have done the installation, I will take you through MongoDB. Okay, so this is the community edition where you will be actually visualizing the data, and you'll be able to store and locate the data whatever you've set. Okay, so let's go to the MongoDB. I'll open the database viewer over here and I'll share the GUI. Okay, this is how the MongoDB GUI will look like. So this is the free version or the community version. Once you have a database which you want to be private and things like that, then you would need to go into an enterprise edition where you will have a private database and things like that. Okay, so once you are click over here, let's just click on connect. Okay, so we click on connect. This is how my database basically looks like. Okay, so I have admin database, I have config database, I have local database, and I have temporary database. Okay, so let's see what is the code that we had written and where should the file be. be same. Okay, so let's open up the Node.js code. Let's go to Atom, and in Atom let's open the app.js code. Let me share the screen with you. Okay, so this is the code in which we are writing the information that we have. So for example, we had sent some value of 36 and 38, if you remember. So the location where the database would be present is over here. It's called localhost/temper. Okay, so in the temporary location, the values will be stored as a string value or a test data. So it will send the data from your web server or your application server into the database like this. Okay, so let's go back to our database. Hopefully everyone is getting the Mongo DB GUI like this. So let me just start a poll. Let's open the poll. I have a poll which is open. Okay, so this is how my MongoDB console or the database will look like. Okay, so there are multiple database names. Right now, if you remember, in the code we had a database name called temper. So we have the values of temper over here. And if you remember, there were two values which were pushed into this database. So if you remember, the values were 36 and 38. So these are the two values which were pushed into the database. So let's try and see if we can push another value into the database. Okay, so let me stop sharing this. Share the screen. Let's go back to the folder where our DIY playground is present. Let's type cmd. We should get the command line. If you remember the code, is node mon app.js. Right? So now your server has started at this location. Once you have started the server, okay, so now I go into my website, which is localhost :3000. Okay, so let's go to this localhost website. Okay, so now the value is 31, for example. Okay, we submit 31 into the database. Now I submit another value, 27, into the database. So if you see now, there should be four such values which are stored in the temporary database on your MongoDB console. Okay, so let's go over here. Let's go back. Okay, so in your temper, there were two documents and now there are four documents. Now you see over here, so you could open up the MongoDB compass again over here. Click on connect. Go to temper. And you have four documents. If you remember that the first one was 36, then it was 38, and the fourth one was 31, and the third one was 31, and the fourth one was 27. Okay. So this is how you can store all your values from a web server into a database which is your MongoDB. You could also store it in other databases like the Google databases and other kinds of databases. But over here, this is what people use in the industry, and this is a far more reliable database tool. So we use MongoDB to store the data from my application server into into my headers. Okay, so this was the experiment. You could maybe try it on once or few more times and try to connect the sensor over here and try to send the sensor value directly into your database with a click of a button. Okay, so there will be a few more experiments which we would be showing you, but I think, let me just see. Okay, so once we've actually finished the storing of the database, let me just start a small poll to see how many of you all have finished the database. So please click on your poll so that we know you are able to catch up and finish all the experiments. Okay, great. So there's the last poll which I have just opened. If you are able to see the information on the whatever you have mentioned, please click on the poll so that we get to know if you are able to complete it. This kind of brings to the end. Maybe for the people who are not able to do it, we will be able to show you how to do it one by one. For the people who have finished, I think this is the end of today's workshop, today's WebEx on cloud computing. This was more a theory session. We had installations and we took in into consideration how to install MongoDB and Node.js and how to run a databasing script. Okay, so you could go through the scripts and see, change a few parameters and say, make it work for your requirement in your application. Tomorrow we will be showing you how to deploy these servers. Okay, so the topic for tomorrow will be server deployment and configuration. This will be completely hands-on and based on whatever you did today, you will be taking it one step further. So I hope that people have understood. People who have not installed Node.js and MongoDB, please do so, because we wouldn't have the time to install the same tomorrow. Okay, so we will be showing you how to install and how to deploy the servers and how to configure them for your requirements, and you could use it for your cohort ideas or any projects that you are doing. Okay, so we'll see you tomorrow, same time, 5:30, the WebEx will start. So thanks for attending today's workshop on cloud computing. Hope everyone got a slightly clearer idea of what cloud computing is. In the duration of these four workshops, we will take you through the field application development, where I think you could use the same, whatever we've taught you into your cohort ideas, and will make your ideas cloud compatible. Okay, so hope to see you all tomorrow for the workshop on server deployment. We have done the theory part. Let's get into the hands-on from tomorrow and see how an actual server is deployed and configured. Okay, so I'll see you guys tomorrow. Hope this workshop was interesting. Please put in your feedbacks. Go through the content of today's workshop so that you know how you will use this in your own projects. Okay, thank you so much. It was a great audience. See you tomorrow for the next workshop. Thank you.